Okay, so let's continue with the skeletal system. We did a little bit of bone anatomy, long bone and flat bone anatomy last time. So let's now move on with studying in more detail compact bone tissue and spongy bone tissue. And I'm going to actually, let's start with the slide, and I may have to do a little bit of drawing on a separate slide. So when we look at compact bone tissue, which, by the way, we tend to find, and notice where I'm pointing here, we tend to find that in the bone color primarily. Remember, the bone color is literally the wall of your long bone. It's mostly compact bone tissue. There's a little bit of spongy bone tissue, but mostly compact. The little square right here, you guys, just to give you a heads up, that little chunk should represent this image, but really their little square should be on the other side of the bone color over there. Okay, because if you look at the image here, then it does, the spongy bone tissues over here, that tells us we're getting closer to the medullary cavity. So they kind of flip-flopped it by accident, just to make sure you're aware of that. By the way, compact bone tissue can also be called dense or cortical bone tissue. You're going to see that there are an incredible number of synonyms for anything and everything in anatomy. And most often you'll have to know all those synonyms, because depending on what book you pick up, depending on which health professional you interact with, they will use different terminology. Okay, now compact bone tissue is very easy to recognize under a slide. So we'll first look at a diagram and then a slide. And that is because it's made up of all these structures that we call osteons, and they're synonyms for them. And they look like all these cut tree trunks. So I see many osteons here. And as I said, there are synonyms for them. And you can see the synonym right here. Haversian systems is a synonym for osteons. Many structures in the body are named after the person that discovered it, and then we're also giving it, many of these structures, a new name with not the person's name. Don't ask me why. Go talk to the anatomists. What's that?
Such a confuse us.
It confuses us too. We have to teach it. Now, if you focus on just one of these osteons, then just like a tree trunk, notice that there are all these concentric layers inside, right? And each one of these layers inside of an osteon, you call a lamella. So let me see if I can blow this up a little bit. So if we blow this up like so, and I use a pen, then this is a lamella, the one that I'm putting little stripes in now. And then here's another lamella. And so on. You guys follow that? So these are layers. Lamella or layer, lamelli, layers. Let me use the other color here. And they occur in these concentric configurations, meaning you have a circle within a circle within a circle within a circle, and that forms the osteon. In the very center of an osteon, you're going to have a good-sized canal, and in that canal are all these vessels, blood vessels, artery and veins, as well as lymphatic and nerve vessels. Remember, your bone tissue is very vascularized. It's innervated. It's even drained by the lymphatic system. Now, that canal, we're going to also give a name. Since this whole structure, what is the whole structure called, circled in the black? What is that called? An osteon. So we can call this an osteonic canal. It has many synonyms. Here we go. What is the other name for the osteon? For the osteon. Haversian canal. So a haversian system. So we can call it a haversian canal. I'm going to abbreviate. And as Daniel just said, yet a third synonym, because of its location, we can call it a central canal as well. Crazy, huh? So all the same name for the same canal. Now you can see these canals continuing down the length of these haversian systems or osteons, and they run nicely through the center. But notice that there are also canals, again filled with blood vessels, nerve vessels, and lymphatic vessels, that run transversely through the compact bone. You can see them really well where I'm pointing now. And since they run transversely, we can call them the transverse canals. Oops, or let me move this. Or we can even call them the perforating canals. So perforating canals or transverse canals. And there is, of course, a third synonym after the person that discovered them, and that is Volkmann's canals. So what do these canals do, or what is their importance? Well, when you take a look at the osteonic canals or the central canals, and now compare them, so that's these guys, and now compare them to the Volkmann's canals, notice that the Volkmann's canals literally interconnect the haversian canals or the central canals. You see that happening? Now, all of these blood vessels, by the way, will start to branch and branch and branch and branch. And what is the smallest level of a blood vessel? A capillary, right? Ultimately, we're going to end up with capillaries that will reach the individual bone cells. So where are the bone cells located? Well, if you look at one of these osteons, then you see these little branchy type of cells, or cells with little branches, and those are osteocytes. Most of the time, we only see their nucleus, by the way. But these are osteocytes that sit in lacunae, or in a lacuna. So where else did we see lacunae? In what? In cartilage tissue, right? All cartilage cells sit in lacunae. This would be a fantastic question for an upcoming test, right? What does bone tissue and cartilage tissue share? Lacunae could be an answer. What do they not share? Vascularization. Cartilages are not vascularized, bone tissues are vascularized. So those are the kinds of things I look for to ensure that I can test and see that you can keep all of these tissues straight in your head. Now, with regards to the lamellae, and without spending too much time on that, there are lamellae that make up the osteons. Those are the concentric lamellae, and it's kind of an obvious name to give them that name, concentric. But there are also lamellae that fill up the spaces in between the osteons. So anytime you have circular structures, you have spaces like here and here where we cannot put concentric lamellae. And so there we're going to find lamellae that look more like this. And I'm just sort of sketching them. You guys can't see that green, can you? So they look more like this. You see what I'm saying? They kind of fill in that space there. So those kinds of lamellae we tend to refer to as the interstitial lamellae. And then there are lamellae that go all the way around the bone. You see them right there. So they go all the way around, and we call them circumferential lamellae, and you see that spelled right there. Okay, so depending on where the lamellae are, we give them different names. My most important concern, or the most important thing I want you to know, is what are lamellae? Okay, not so much. They're different names, although that would be nice. It'll make it easier for you to do your assignments. Any questions about this diagram? Let's take a look at this diagram. Hopefully that'll make sense now. What we've done here is we've pulled out one what? What is this? One osteon. Very good. And you can see here the medullary cavity. And notice that even though the bone color or the wall of the diaphysis is mostly compact bone tissue, as we get nearby the medullary cavity, we do see a little bit of spongy bone tissue. And then we also have a membrane lining that medullary cavity, right? Remember what that's called? We looked at the two bone membranes last time. Do you remember? Go dig endostium. Around in your notes. What's that?
Endostium.
Endostium, that's right. So on the periphery, covering the whole bone, we have a bone membrane called the periosteum, lining the medullary cavity and also lining the canals that we just studied. We find endostium. Remember those two bone membranes? Always bring your notes from the time before, you guys, so you can go back to them, particularly since I will often make sure that I reiterate some of the information we discussed. What are these canals here? What are these guys? These right here are your eversion or central canals, while these guys are the transverse or Volkmann's canals, exactly. So here we see a typical microscope slide of compact bone tissue. Compact bone tissue is one of the easiest slides to recognize under a microscope. This is a lower magnification, and then we'll take a look at a higher magnification. But it's easy to see all the osteons, right? There's one. I mean, I don't think it's hard to see them, right, you guys? And then in the very center, what is this here? That's your central canal. What do we find in there?
Blood vessels.
Lymphatic vessels and nerve vessels. Very good. See all the tiny little spots everywhere? What are those? Your osteocytes. When I put my stylus on it, the pointer is actually a little bit above my stylus, so sometimes I'm a little off. Yes, those are your osteocytes. You can see them nicely here, right? And they have little branches. If I were to draw an osteocyte, and I'm looking at, give me just a second here, is this it? How do I do that again? Add a page. Nope, that's not what I want to do. Give me just a second, you guys. I'm supposed to be able to create an empty page here. So if we draw an osteocyte, it's kind of a branchy cell like so. Should have used a different color, but it'll have to do. There's your nucleus. And it sits in a lacuna. So I'm going to just draw a little circle kind of sort of around it. I put some stripes in there, and that's the lacuna. You guys with me there? Now, the branches of these cells, they're going to meet tiny little canals. And I'm going to just use the same color because it's more difficult in this view. I have to switch colors. But so you imagine that there's all these little canals, sort of like so. They're tiny, they're microscopic, all right, because we're looking at just a single cell. And guess what's inside of those tiny little canals? Inside of these tiny little canals, you have capillaries. And it's these capillaries that nourish the osteocytes and collect the wastes. Now, of course, we need to give these little canals a name. And a little canal in Latin is canaliculus. So you spell canal, and then you add iculus at the end. What would be the plural version? Canaliculi. Okay? There's a U here and a U there. Maybe a little hard for you guys to read. But so that's how these osteocytes are nourished and taken care of. Where do these capillaries come from? There are branches and branches and branches of the bigger vessels of inside of the eversion canals and the transverse canals, right? Okay, let's go back to this mode. So that's compact bone tissue. Any questions about the compact bone tissue? Yes, Daniel.
Where is the blood entering the bone?
Good question. Last time we learned about, I deleted those slides because we covered that already, but if you look at the, since you have your computer in front of you, if you look at the long bone, we talked about the nutrient arteries and veins, and that's where a lot of that blood is coming in. And then there are some arteries and veins that come in to the epiphyses through the periosteum in the, along the diaphysis. See that? Yeah, good question. So we finished compact bone tissue. Let's take a look at spongy bone tissue. We did a little bit of it last time, but not a whole lot. Now, spongy bone tissue is most commonly found in the epiphyses. Remember, the epiphyses are the ends of long bones. Here we see one of those ends. But remember, we also have a little bit of spongy bone at the, you know, just underneath that endosteum that lines the medullary cavity. And then, of course, we switch to compact bone tissue. So the epiphyses are primarily spongy bone tissue. Of course, it can be solely spongy bone tissue. They always are going to have a thin layer, a thin layer of compact bone tissue to strengthen them. And then don't forget that the ends of long bones tend to be covered with articular cartilage that's made up of hyaline cartilage, right? You guys have learned about that already. So let's take a closer look at spongy bone tissue. So spongy bone tissue is full of holes, and these holes are created because of this, the bone tissue being arranged into these struts or beams. So here's one of these struts and here's one of these beams. I mean, whatever you want to call these, the scientific name that we're going to give them is trabeculae. One trabecula, many trabeculae. Now, if we cut through one of these trabeculae, like we did here, notice that once again we see lamellae. But they're typically not, even though it's a little bit misleading, it looks like an osteon, but it's not. There's no haversian canal. And these lamellae often are not going to be forming concentric circles. As a matter of fact, often they're kind of arranged into a spiral more than anything else. Okay? So the point I'm making here is that unlike compact bone tissue, spongy bone tissue does not have osteons. A key feature for compact bone tissue is the presence of those osteons or haversian systems. No osteons with haversian canals or central canals in spongy bone tissue. What we do have, which we do not find in compact bone tissue, is trabeculae in spongy bone tissue. So trabeculae are kind of unique to the spongy bone tissue. So if we slice through one of these trabeculae, then we see this view. So we see our lamellae, right? But also notice that each trabecula is covered with a bunch of cells. And these cells form that bone membrane we've been mentioning, and that is the endosteum. So we don't just have endosteum lining the medullary cavity. We don't just have endosteum lining the canals. We see that endosteum is also going to be surrounding or covering all of these trabeculae. And so what is in the endosteum? Well, we will learn more about these cells today, but we began to mention them last time. That is your bone builders, your osteoblasts, which typically look almost like they have the shape of a cuboidal epithelial cell very often. They're not epithelial cells, don't get me wrong, but they have that square look to them. The other ones are the osteoclasts, which are huge, multinucleated cells, and they're the ones that break down bone tissue. And amidst these osteoblasts and osteoclasts, and they're not really specifying that, we have a third bone cell type. Does anybody remember what that one is that we looked at last time? It's a stem cell. A bone stem cell, the osteoprogenitor or osteogenic cells. We'll look at them again. So if you didn't quite get that, we're getting to that momentarily. Okay, what do we often find in the spaces of spongy bone tissue, such as right here, in these spaces here and here, very often that is where you would find red bone marrow. And sometimes we call that hematopoietic tissue. Let me change this color to black. There we go. Okay. So those were our two bone tissues. Remember, compact bone tissue, its key feature is the presence of osteons or haversian systems with central canals. On the other hand, spongy bone tissue lack osteons. They do have lamellae, but what do they have that compact bone doesn't have? Trabeculae, right? Keep that straight in your head. So we're going to take a closer look now at what bone tissue is made up of. And we're going to pay attention to the organic as well as the inorganic components. Now remember, you've learned before what the difference is between organic and inorganic. Inorganic, or I should say organic molecules, compounds, they contain carbon inside of them, right? They have carbon. Except, you know, there's exceptions to that rule, clearly. Carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, we don't consider those to be organic molecules, even though they contain carbon. But your proteins, your sugars, your lipids, your nucleic acids, all these molecules that make up cells are considered organic. And therefore, we put our bone cells into the organic pile. Now, some of these bone cells, remember the osteoblasts, what do they do again? They secrete materials to make bone tissue. They're the bone builders. Now we're going to specify exactly what they secrete. And what those osteoblasts secrete is something called osteoid. And be sure you really know the definition of osteoid, because we're going to be throwing that term around left and right next time. So osteoid is bone tissue's matrix, but not just that. There's a little bit more to the definition. All of you know by now what matrix is, right? Because bone tissue is a connective tissue, so it's going to have a matrix, which is the extracellular material. But the secretion that these osteoblasts make is not mineralized. And so osteoid is an unmineralized version of the bone matrix. And so pretty much the goopy gooey stuff, all those proteins and sugars, and then a bunch of collagen fibers. Lots and lots of collagen fibers in bone tissue, lots of them. So the osteoid, the bone cells, form the organic component of bone tissue. And so all of those minerals are the inorganic material. And of course, the most important minerals are your calcium and phosphate. The most predominant are the calcium and the phosphate ions. And we'll take a look at what we call those in just a moment. Everybody clear on what we mean by osteoid? So if I were to ask you to define osteoid for me, you would have to give me a definition like it is unmineralized bone matrix, or it's extracellular material in bone tissue that is not mineralized yet, something along those lines. Okay? Which means, and if I asked you, well, I'll explain what we find in it, you would have to say it's the ground substance plus the collagen fibers, but no minerals. That's very important for you to be aware of. So to expand a little bit on the minerals and the strength of bone tissue, because the minerals, of course, contribute to the strength, it's actually really hard to break bone or to make it crack or fracture. We can compare it to steel, and we'll do that in the next slide. You know, it's really hard to push on bone and make it break, and it's really hard to pull on bone and make it break. And a lot of that has to do with the amount of minerals present. Notice that 65% of the bone is made up of minerals, And 65%, by the way, is about two-thirds. 66% would be two-thirds. So that's a lot. So the rest, one-third, is what? If two-thirds is, what's that?
Organic.
Organic, right, which is bone cells and osteoid. Now notice that we have all kinds of minerals, but the calcium and the phosphate ions, they get together and they form these crystals that we call hydroxyapatites. Hydroxyapatites. So hydroxyapatites are the calcium phosphate crystals that form in our bone tissue, and they are primarily responsible for the hardness of the bone. So as I said, we tend to compare bone tissue to steel. It's half as strong as steel when it comes to resisting compression. You'll see in your assignment questions, there's a lot of questions. Well, it depends on which ones you pull, but that talk about tensile strength of bone tissue, tensile strength or tensile strength. And what that refers to is the fact that it's very difficult to break bone by pulling on it. Bear in mind, too, that your minerals persist after we die. So even when we're dead, there's still lots of evidence of who we were, even from people of millions of years ago. And so it gives us a lot of information, these minerals, about history. Okay, so let's now move on to the organic bone components. And we've already mentioned these bone cells, and we'll keep mentioning them because they play a very important role in our upcoming lectures next week. So remember, the organic material consists of osteoid. You know by now what that is. You also know that it's the osteoblasts that secrete that, our so-called bone builders, and that all these bone cells contribute to the formation of organic bone material. So here we have our osteocytes. You might want to add a little note to yourself here that they always sit inside lacunae. They didn't draw them that way. And they are really the only bone tissues, bone cells that are within the actual bone tissue. They are totally surrounded by other osteocytes and the minerals. While the other cells tend to be more present in the bone membrane, so not in the bone tissue. They're present, all of them are present in the bone organ, but really the osteocytes are present inside of the bone tissue. So the osteoblasts, they're the ones that secrete the osteoid. Notice that they do look a little bit cuboidal, see that? And we'll skip for a second the osteogenic cell, and the osteoclasts are your bone breaker downers. That's a very scientific way of saying that, right? They break down the bone tissue. We'll look at them one more time in just a moment. And then there are the bone stem cells, which we can call osteogenic or osteoprogenitor. And I'll show you the synonym for that in just a moment. But if you listen to the term osteogenic, what does it literally say? Making of bone, creation of bone, right? As in osteogenesis. Yes. And where do we find the osteoblasts, osteogenic, and osteoclasts? Where?
In the periosteum.
In the periosteum and in the endosteum, right? So in those bone membranes. And more specifically, in that cellular layer of the periosteum, which we call the osteogenic layer. We looked at that last time. Your periosteum, which covers the diaphysis, has an external layer that's primarily fibrous, and then an internal layer that actually touches the compact bone tissue, which is made up of these cells called the osteogenic layer. There you see that term again, osteogenic. So let's take a look at the differentiation pathway of these different bone cells. Remember, bone tissue is a type of connective tissue. And therefore, just like any other connective tissue, where do the bone tissues arise from, or from what kind of cells? They're all going to arise from mesenchyme cells. And of course, an embryo has literally mesenchyme tissue, meaning lots and lots of mesenchyme cells put together to form a mesenchyme tissue. But even within our body, remember, as born and as grown up human beings, we have mesenchyme cells. And notice the differentiation pathway. So mesenchyme cells give rise to all of these bone cells we've just discussed. Notice that now I use the term osteoprogenitor cells. That's the same thing as the osteogenic cells. Synonym. Osteogenic or osteoprogenitor cells, same thing. So if we take a look at the left-hand side of our differentiation pathway, notice that our osteoprogenitor cells are the ones that are going to be responsible for differentiating further into osteoblasts, which then become osteocytes. Notice that the osteoclasts have a totally different route. They actually, we think, are formed by the stem cell that also gives rise to all of our blood cells. Remember, the hematopoietic stem cell gave rise to white blood cells, red blood cells, platelets, and we think it gives rise to osteoclasts as well. These osteoclasts are very much like macrophages, and macrophages are literally white blood cells that left the bloodstream. Have any of you ever heard of a white blood cell called a monocyte? If not, don't worry about it. But there are white blood cells that are quite big called monocytes, and when they leave the bloodstream and enter into the connective tissues, they change a little bit and become a macrophage, a voracious eater. Remember, macrophages devour all kinds of pathogens. Well, osteoclasts express similar behavior and similar features. So we think these osteoclasts may arise from these hematopoietic stem cells. So very different pathways for osteoblasts and osteocytes versus the osteoclasts. Quick question, which one of these two stem cells, the osteogenic or the hematopoietic stem cell, is most differentiated or least differentiated? Well, let's stick to one question. Which one is the least differentiated? Which one of these two? These, the osteoprogenitor cells, or the hematopoietic stem cells? Which ones are most differentiated, do you think? The hematopoietic cells are most differentiated or least? They're actually the least differentiated, probably, because they can give rise to all kinds of blood cells plus these bone cells, too. Osteoprogenitor cells are really limited. They literally, their name tells you, they're limited to only giving rise to bone cells. Does that click a little bit? So your osteoprogenitor cells have already differentiated a few steps well beyond your hematopoietic stem cells. Hematopoietic stem cells can give rise to more than just blood cells. Just something to ponder through, you guys. Any questions about this? This is kind of important stuff, that you really understand that osteoclasts are kind of different cells than osteoblasts and osteocytes. Okay, so just as a reminder here, this is a slide that explains where you find the cells that we just listed and what they do. Osteoclasts, one more time. Let's take a look now at what exactly they do. We know they break down bone tissue, but how do they go about that? They're these big cells. I'll kind of redraw one of them. They're these big cells, and they have what we call a ruffled border. Basically, one side of the cells has these finger-like projections, and we refer to that as the ruffled border. I guess they don't have that labeled here. Oh, I have it. It's right here. So I'll just do a pointer like so. And what we find inside of that ruffled border is a protein called actin. You're going to hear a lot about actin, especially in the muscular system, because this is what we call a contractile protein. What does that mean, contractile? Has something to do with contracting, right? So these little fingers that you see here, the so-called ruffled border, actually think of them as fingers with which this big multinucleated osteoclast grabs on to the bone tissue. Because these actin proteins can kind of change the shape of those fingers. Those fingers can go like our fingers do, grab onto something. And so they can sit there, these osteoclasts, and do their thing. And what is their thing? Their thing is to break down bone tissue. And how do they do that? Well, they do it in two ways. They secrete enzymes, and they secrete acids. Now, what would the acids do, you think?
Minerals.
Yes, they're going to break down the minerals, right? The acids are going to take care of taking apart those hydroxyapatites. Remember, the hydroxyapatites are those calcium phosphate crystals. Now, why would we want osteoclasts to take apart these hydroxyapatites? What would be a scenario that would be an example for why this should occur?
Reuse.
Reuse of what?
Of
calcium and phosphate, yes, exactly. And what would be an example of why we would want to do that?
To make new bone.
To make new bone maybe somewhere else, yes. Yeah, okay. And how is this all going to work? So we have these acids, these osteoclasts are spitting out these acids. We are now having calcium ions and phosphate ions. Where do they go so that we can use them? Right, so they have to diffuse into the bloodstream, and that's going to work okay because we actually have all kinds of capillaries in the bone tissues. So yes, and then the enzymes are always going to take care of the organic component, that is the cells, the collagen fibers, the ground substance, all right? So for instance, if our calcium levels in our blood are too low, then we would maybe send a signal to the osteoclasts and tell them, hey, munch on a little bit of bone tissue because we need to rise those levels of calcium in the bloodstream. You see how this is kind of a negative feedback mechanism? We'll look at the hormonal control of calcium levels in the blood next week. But there are going to be constant signals between these osteoblasts and osteoclasts and your endocrine system to maintain calcium levels in the blood. Any other questions? We're a little bit ahead of the other class, but that's okay.
The little holes in the trabeculae, what causes that? Is it the osteoclast or is it?
Oh, I see. Good question. So the question is, what the little holes in the spongy bone tissue, how do they get there? Yes. As a matter of fact, this kind of leads to what we're going to do next. We're going to learn how bone is formed. And a lot of our discussion is going to revolve not just about how is bone deposited, how is it resorbed, which is what we just discussed with the osteoclasts, but also the osteoclasts' role very often is to shape a bone, just like they shape the trabeculae. Yes. So, and we'll see how that happens. Any other questions? Yes.
So say like when... For kids, when their bones are growing, would that be something with the acid, like to rebuild it?
No, we're going to look at the lengthening of bone tissue. And that's where that growth plate, the epiphyseal plate, is going to play a very important role. We will look at that. So you'll get that question answered. Yes. But you should always bear in mind that osteoblasts and osteoclasts are constantly busy in your body now, when you were a little baby, way back into the fetus, and even as you grow old. They're always busy, 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 busy doing stuff. And there's always some form of shaping bone tissue going on. Okay, so what's coming next is something what called ossification, and what you see on the screen right now is saying intramembrane is ossification. But before we go to the specific type of ossification, let me just kind of get you set up for what's to come. So from this point forward and into next week, and at the next Wednesday we'll wrap up this chapter, we're going to primarily focus on how our skeletal system is formed in the fetus. Then we're going to take a look at how we grow, not just lengthwise, but our bones also have to thicken as we grow, otherwise we'd be, you know, we'd have these long spindly bones. Then we'll also take a look at what happens to our bones when, you know, when we're your age, and then when we're getting older. Like, I am in menopause, I'm losing estrogen, and so there are changes happening to my bone density. As a matter of fact, osteoclasts are starting to be a bit more active than those osteoblasts. So we're going to look at all these different phases in our lives. And it's really important for you to always bear in mind, where are we? Are we talking about the fetus right now? Are we talking about a growing child right now? Where are we? So that you can really understand what's going on. Even though many of the phases that we're going to be studying kind of seem the same from time period to time period in our lives, they're all very related. So we might as well get started with this. And we'll start with what's happening in the fetus. In the fetus, we're going to see that there are two different ways in which bones are formed. The majority of our bones are going to be formed by starting from a piece of hyaline cartilage. So for instance, imagine this tiny little fetus that's growing in the mother's womb. That tiny little fetus will start to develop little chunks of cartilage, let's say where the humerus or where the ulna and the radius, where the fingers need to form. And, you know, initially it just remains cartilage and the cartilage cells divide, and that's how the whole structure gets longer and bigger in general. And then there comes a point somewhere around the 6th or 8th week into pregnancy, often when we don't even know we're pregnant. And blood is triggered to move into this little piece of cartilage. And that's when everything changes. When blood manages to invade that piece of cartilage, we're going to see that little by little, that cartilage piece, you know, maybe there was like a little stump in that fetus, that was a little model, cartilage model to build our bone model on. That little piece of cartilage, that model of cartilage, is going to start falling apart. All the cartilage cells begin to die, and little by little, we start to see that these osteoblasts start to deposit osteoid. And exactly how that happens, we will talk about. So that's the way the majority of our bones are formed in the fetus. We start with what? We start with a little piece of hyaline cartilage. And so because of that, we refer to that form of ossification, ossification meaning the making of bone, we refer to that as endochondral ossification. I'm going to take a look ahead at what's coming up next. Yes, so we have it here on this slide. So you see it spelled right there. And notice the word endochondral. What does that word literally say? Say inside cartilage, right? So this is the most common way in which we build bones as a fetus. The other method of ossification is called intramembranous ossification. Intra means what? Inside as well. Endo, intra mean the same thing. On occasion on the internet, you guys, you see people getting very sloppy with their spelling and they talk about intermembranous. No, 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 no. It's intra. What does inter mean? The prefix inter. as an interstitial or intercession in between, right? So inter means in between, intra means within. If I talk about intracellular versus intercellular, we're in totally different locations, aren't we? Yeah, very important. So just as a quick preview, in the case of intramembranous ossification, and you see that spelled right here, we're going to see that we start with just a bunch of fibers. Remember, we're in a fetus here. It's not very organized and very matured. We have a bunch of fibers with a bunch of mesenchyme cells thrown in between. Now, which types of bones arise from this membranous model? Not that many. Some of your skull bones, your flat skull bones, and your facial and some of your flat cranial bones, they are formed by intramembranous ossification. And then some, for some bizarre reason, your clavicles are in that pile as well. And that's about it. So not a whole lot of bones. So the rest of your bones, pretty much all of them, or most of them, are going to follow endochondral ossification. Okay? So in order for us to form a skull bone, let's say the frontal bone or the parietal bone in the fetus, in that area where that skull bone needs to form, there are going to be some fibers laid down with a bunch of mesenchyme cells in between, and that's sort of the beginning of that flat bone. And then again, it becomes ossified, and we'll see how that works next time. I'm going to let you guys go a little early today.